Good evening, and welcome to another edition of Centering on Peace. I'm Blair Seitz, your host tonight, and I have three distinguished guests with me, and we have a very exciting topic to talk with you about for Berks County. We are talking about bringing a Cuban artist from Cuba to Reading. So, first of all, though, let me say that we are sponsored by the Wells Fargo Foundation, and also by Berks Peace Group. Berks Peace meets on Monday evening, the first Monday of every month. And it's at 7 o'clock, and it's at the Friends Meeting House on the 600 block of 6th Street. So come and join us there, 7 o'clock at the Friends Quaker Meeting House. So let me introduce our guests tonight. I'm going to start with Marty. Or Martha Ressler is an award-winning artist from Hamburg. Mm-hmm. And she is the chair of the Julio Cepeda Exhibition Committee. Also to my left is Paul Rosa. Yep. And Paul is, he might be helping me tonight because we're doing some IT tonight. he's with the Information Technology Department at Penn State Berks. Also, we have with us, really happy to have with us, Tom McMahon. Tom is former mayor of Reading, and he has a lot of interest in Cuba. He's been there, and so he's also part of this Julio Cepeda Exhibition Committee. So this has been a brainchild of Marty and her husband Jay. They were in Cuba and things started happening. And Marty, tell us about it.
Sure. Jay and I traveled to Cuba last year with a group. While we were there, we visited Trinidad, a city on the southern coast of Cuba, and we had an afternoon off and wandered into an art gallery. We're both artists, so that's where we headed. And there we saw the work of Julio Cepeda. And should I hold this up? This is an original piece by Julio on loan from the artist. This is called The Aviator, and it kind of shows what hit me on a really gut level. His use of found objects, his sense of humor, just the fine artistry, not just using found objects, but combining spaces that let the eye rest with more activity or busyness in other areas, and the way he combines and brings it all together using acrylic paints, mm-hmm. metallic and otherwise.
So you saw this in a gallery in Trinidad, mm-hmm. in Cuba. So where did you go from there?
We almost immediately, I had the vision of him being able to show his work at GoggleWorks in Reading. Mm-hmm. I could see the recycled theme and the humor and the found objects. I thought an exhibit would work really well there. And I could envision how organizing such an exhibit, massive undertaking as it was, mm-hmm. could help build bridges between Reading and Cuba and among those of us here in Reading who were interested in working on it. So we left our name with the gallery owner, didn't have a chance to meet Julio at that trip. Mm. She passed it on to him, he wrote to us.
Oh, wow.
And things went from there. We outlined our ideas. He really liked the idea of coming here and coming to GoggleWorks in Reading. Applied for a show, which will be September 8th to October 12th, 2018. It's still 2 years away.
I want to be sure our viewers understand things that we talk about, which they may not. GoggleWorks Center for the Arts is in sort of central Reading, and it's a very large, several galleries, and there are a lot of artists resident there as well. Mm-hmm. So anytime you come to downtown Reading, you can go to GoggleWorks.
It's actually the largest art center of its type in the country. Six buildings on the campus. It's actually recycled itself because it used to be a, you know, Wilson Goggle factory. So
that's very interesting.
Yeah.
Yes.
This, I want to get back to this piece for a second.
Sure. Go ahead.
Well, the goggles reminded me. It's called the Aviator. Julio tends to fashion his work on someone he knew. In this case, it was a crop duster, a guy who had a plane when he was a kid, and the kids all thought he was really cool because he'd, you know, ride his plane and have these goggles on. So that was the inspiration for this particular piece. Mm-hmm. Anyway, when we got back here, we talked to some friends from Art Plus Gallery, where we're members of that gallery.
In West Reading.
In West Reading. Talk to friends at Albright, talk to anyone we could find, and one person led to another person, led to another person. We started to attend the Wednesday diversity mixers in mm-hmm. Reading and met more people, including Paul, and started one person after another. We now have an active committee of, what, about a dozen who meet on a monthly basis.
And I understand that GoggleWorks has been very helpful in this process. In fact, it's a cooperative project between the committee and GoggleWorks, is that correct?
That is absolutely true. They've been wonderful. We're co-hosting the Cuban Film Festival coming up next month, which we'll hope to be a major fundraiser for us. The legal expenses for Julio to get his visa are quite high. In addition, we have his airfare and shipping this work, which is...
We'll talk more about that.
Which is
Tom,
not cheap.
Let's bring Tom and Paul. Tom, how did you get on the committee? And I mean, what is your interest here?
Well,
besides being you're a very busy person.
No,
so what attracted you to this?
Well, I was in Cuba in February for 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. And it's something I always wanted to do. It's on my bucket list. But I've been really interested in mostly the political situation and the economic development of Cuba. And so when I was there, and I went with a group out of Minneapolis, and it was about 18 people. It's called Global Volunteers. And I've been with them in other countries. Cuba is the second, actually, and Peru as well. But the interest in Cuba that I found in this city, as soon as you tell anyone that you've been to Cuba, they ask a lot of questions. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of Cuban Americans in Reading. It's not the highest population, but there's a lot of Cuban Americans who really are interested in helping come together and get to know each other. But we traveled as part of the project that we were on, as part of a volunteer project. We did go to Trinidad. And it was before I knew that Julio, if I had known that he was there, I would have looked him up, but I didn't meet you folks until afterwards. But the striking thing about art in Cuba, which I think is just magnificent, is that it's everywhere. And the Cuban art, the Cuban music, the Cuban dance, it's really infused the whole society. And from what I understand, and some of my friends from other Central and South American countries, Cuban art has really been a catalyst for a whole lot of other art initiatives in South, Central and South America.
So it must be fun to go around in Cuba to visit all of the nightclubs.
Yes.
And the music. I understand that there's music everywhere.
Oh,
right?
I mean, there's music, and everybody knows how to dance, and everybody knows the music. Mm-hmm. But I was struck by the art that's on the buildings, and it's in the in walkways, and it's just, it's part of people know that it's important to have art. And I love public art, and I'm really a strong proponent of that, and have been. I've been on the board of the GoggleWorks for 11 years since it started. But so I think having Julio here is going to really spark some interest, and I really applaud all of you for taking the time to recognize the talent he has. And also, this might lead to more exchanges. And we can talk later about some other peripheral activities that we'll probably do when he's here, and even before then. Mm.
So, Paul, why are you on this committee?
Well, I was on this committee I was at one of the mixers, and I took an interest in...
The mixers being the committee
diversity,
has been going
yes.
to Latino
yes.
business mixers, is that correct?
Where Absolutely.
Where Latino business owners and associated people get together
yes.
and they socialize.
Yes.
For an hour
and
or so.
They build their network.
Right.
And I was over there by invite, particularly the DoubleTree. Mm-hmm. And I took an interest in the art, and I'm not an art entrepreneur, but it captured my attention, and I was there, and I was speaking with Marty and Jay, and from there it's all history.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I think it's time for us to know Julio Cepeda. Mm-hmm. So they made a video for the committee in Cuba and sent it up to us, and I'm going to play that video right now. And like I said, if I need tech help, I've got the man right beside me. Is this right? This is a wonderful 5-minute video that shows Julio and his and working in his art studio.
We actually commissioned it from a Cuban filmmaker who was in between projects. Mm-hmm. So Julio said, well, if you can get us $400 right away, he has a little bit of time here, we could make this video. So we quickly raised $400 and were able to take advantage of Renone's talents to make this happen. I always have to.
Well, computers are always fun, and I thought I would just double click on this, and it would play, but it didn't do that.
I always have to open this program on mine, this cone thing.
It's for MP4s aren't typically. Unless you have the iTunes on here.
Tom, while we're doing this, tell us more about what you envision for this project.
Well, as we mentioned before, one of the things that I also do is coordinate sister city relationship with the city in Germany, and our Royal League is the city, but. When I went to Cuba, there were people who asked me to try to look into whether it would be possible to establish a sister city relationship between Reading and a city in Cuba. We haven't done that entirely yet, but I think it might be interesting to pursue the next time we go. I'm going to plan to go to Cuba again, hopefully next year, and we can maybe meet with some government officials and talk about the possibility of doing something like this. But I think really important because that Reading is a very heavily Latino city, as we know, that it would be wonderful to have some more participation in from the schools, for example, to be able to have art exchange and to do exchanges like pen pals, but also to just have an exchange of art in both directions. And one of the fascinating things about young Cuban people is that they're getting very much connected in the internet. So They have the opportunity to do that. It's not really very cheap for them yet. It's expensive, but I think it would be a great opportunity here. We've already talked to some schools. Lowry's Park, for example, is right next to the GoggleWorks. They're very close, about a block away, and we have talked to that school about bringing in art teachers from the whole school district to be part of the operation. And when Julio was here, I think we can really promote that very well and let people understand what it is. I think that you're very creative, the aviator, for example.
Now,
but his work, I think, in using older material, but to be able to create some unified whole of it so that it makes some sense, I think is very attractive to what the resources that we have in the city, because we can always.
And Julio is actually coming in 2018. Mm-hmm. So we have lead-up time, and there's a lot to do between now and then, lot that your committee has done. What have you done already, Martha?
Well, gathered a great group of volunteers, number one. Mm-hmm. We started by opening a bank account, setting up a website, Julio Cepeda it's on Weebly.com, and the Facebook page and started fundraising. Our first event was a mixer at Mi Casa Su Casa, a cafe in Reading, and we raised, $1,500 there, which we were able to make a down payment to our lawyer. It took a lot of looking, but found the lawyer that we wanted to use, who's an immigration specialist, and it was suggested that the type of visa that we need is a specialized artist visa, which will allow Julio to be able to sell his works, give workshops. It's almost as good as a temporary worker's visa. It's called an O-1B visa. So this is going to take some doing.
But maybe you talk a little bit more about it. It's not so easy to do this. You're plowing really new ground here, mm-hmm. and opening doors for Cuban artists to come here and vice versa. It's easier for us if we're following one of the 12 mandates that still are in place for the Cuban government, although it's relaxed somewhat now that we have scheduled airfare. But to have the Cubans be able to come here, it really takes a lot of effort, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
And I know, so once you've done it, I think it's going to be a lot easier for others to be able to come and follow the same pathways, right?
I hope so, yes.
Wonderful. I know that I think up till now you've raised about $3,000, but how much do we need?
Speaking
of that, I understand you have a website that might have a way that people can participate.
Yes, let's put that website up now. Could I ask the producer to put up the website? There it is. And in that website, you can see all about Julio. You can play the video that we're trying to play now. And also, you can donate there. There's a donate button. So write down that Julio Cepeda exhibition.weebly.com.
What is your target that you're trying to raise to be able to make sure this happens?
See, the problem is that there's a lot of money that goes into expenses of raising money. Mm-hmm. So to put on the film festival, for example, there were expenses in getting the films and so on.
Nice flyer, by the way. I think you have the flyer there to show.
Yes. show that in a little while.
So there's expenses putting on the film festival. At the same time, you're going to revenue
raising
from
money
there.
For it, exactly.
But you're looking roughly, you have 3,000 already, roughly. So you're looking.
But we spent a lot of that too.
Yeah, correct. Yeah.
So,
okay. I understand.
I mean, our major expense will be the legal expense. It's over $4,000. The airfare, we can probably get him here and back for $500, something like that. Mm-hmm. I don't know exactly, but that's not a major thing. The shipping of the work is going to be an expense because it's not just like rolling up a canvas, but there's weight to it. There's a lot of careful packing that has to go into it. He has started to ship his work up. These are on loan. He has another box on its way. So he's starting to ship it up as he gets it done. And we'll just find
a place to store it. So that's not a problem from shipping from Cuba to here. I mean, through the customs and immigration and all the
It takes a long time. There's supposedly direct U.S. mail service now, but it still takes over a month.
I understand that you have your fingers crossed on quite a few things.
Yeah,
I mean, it's this thing of interchange with Cuba is, of course, a rather new thing.
Yeah.
So
exactly.
We're going to in September. I understand that you're having a film festival, a Cuban film festival, an opportunity for everyone to see four really good Cuban films. We're going to show a trailer of one of those films, but Paul, I think you can give us now a little overview of what those films are going to be.
Sure, I have several films here. There's four of them. The first one is Alan Brolin's.
You're showing one film each weekend.
Per weekend, yes, throughout the month of September. Mm-hmm. For example, Alan Brolin's is being shown September 3rd, September 4th. It's by Bruce Donnelly. It's a documentary featuring the lives of 12 contemporary Cuban artists living in Havana today. And what they do, they get interviewed, and it covers a diverse range of subjects and issues, from supply shortages, constant blackouts to family, love, life, sex, and music. They visit each artist in their home and in their studio. And the film also explores the varying styles and themes in their work.
And the second movie, The Second Weekend.
Is Memories of Underdevelopment. And that's by Thomas Gutierrez Zelaya. It talks about Sergio, who's a wealthy, aspiring writer. He decided to stay in Cuba while his friends and family, they flee and they move to Miami. Sergio, the writer, he looks back over the changes stemming from the Cuban Revolution to the Missile Crisis.
This is a novel, and it's a classic that I understand from 1968.
Yes. Yep. The other one is They Would All Be Queens by Gustavo Perez. It's about several Soviet women who marry Cuban men, and they moved back to Cuba in the 1980s. And when the Soviet Union fall and Cuba entered the special period where food is scarce and or non-existent, those women find themselves trapped in an unimaginable situation. And the last film is called Unfinished Spaces. And that's by Lisa Namias and Benjamin Murray. It pertains to Cuba's ambitious National Art School project that was designed by three young artists. In the wake of Castro's revolution, it was neglected and nearly forgotten, then ultimately rediscovered as a visionary architectural masterpiece. Those are the four films that will be shown in September.
Wonderful. I think we'll be able to show a trailer of the first movie about the the artists. Let's talk about this a bit more. I know you showed this. I wonder if the cameras can come in close on this. So in looking at this, what I like is the aviator eyes and the face. And Julio has put so many different objects that he's found in, like people bring objects, I understand, to him from the dump or from around town, anything that he finds. And he's able to put these together in such a fascinating way. Let us look now at the trailer.
Tierra no es mía, no es de nadie. Es mía por amor y también por sangre. Yo, si buscaré otro sitio, este. No hay otro.
Parece que el arte transmite en la misma medida que se hace misterioso.
Me gusta pensar que los cubanos tenemos una manera especial a la cubana de hacer las cosas.
Yo creo que el arte cubano, estoy seguro que tiene un lugar, importante.
Aquí en Cuba es muy sencillo hacerse surrealista. Casi nada más que hay que salir con un papel y un lápiz a copiar lo que está pasando.
Ellos, hay veces que me dicen, mira, Miguel, no salgas tanto, no estés tanto por la calle, ponte a pintar. Pero no se han dado cuenta que mi trabajo tiene que ver con esto de la calle.
El periodo especial fue un trauma muy grande. Comenzó en el año 91 con la caída del campo socialista, el muro de Berlín.
Era un momento muy complicado para la realidad cubana y eso yo creo que marcó el mayor trabajo de la plástica cubana, ¿no? De los años 90.
A mí no me interesa la política porque a mí me tocó ser artista.
Yo realmente no te puedo responder qué cosa es el arte. No puedo.
Let's have a look at Julio. His face. Well, let me show you first. This is a poster that you will be seeing around town announcing the movies. Can we put this on the screen? Okay, you'll be seeing this around town. It has all the description of the four movies.
So did you mention
the times and everything?
That it's, yeah, okay, it's 11 o'clock on Saturdays and Sundays. Mm-hmm. Of all the weekends in September, correct? Is that correct? Mm-hmm. So that's easy to put down in a calendar, so people can put in a calendar and make sure that they come along and see it. And the fact they all do have English subtitles, I think.
Right? Correct.
It's also correct. Yes. So it's a good way to learn your Spanish. Practice your Espanol. while you're doing that, I think it's mm-hmm. interesting to note that a lot of the Cuban films have won really very major awards in the U.S. and around the world, and for the Cuban filmmakers who really established themselves in a genre that they really are very, very good at. So combining art and cinema and telling the true stories of Cuba, as you mentioned, since the revolution and then what they euphemistically call a special period.
That yeah. having been said, it's the U.S. embargo against Cuba is still very much in place. Some people misunderstand and think that it's gone now, but it's not. That's a law, and it would take a congressional act to make that disappear. So there have been some liberalizations and steps towards normalization between the U.S. government and Cuba, but it's still very rare to see these wonderful movies that Tom and Paul described. So this is a really good chance to see these movies and get a peek at.
It's interesting to note that the Cubans
more,
still call it the blockade. They call it a blockade rather than embargo in a lot of cases, even though the ships don't blockade other ships physically, but the net effect is an embargo on the importation of, and a lot of it is a result of the lack of a financial connections between the major banks in the U.S. and the banks in Cuba for exchange and credit. So I think we're getting ready to be able to bring that up then.
We have the video of Julio Cepeda.
Good, there you go, and, nice going.
This is about 5 minutes long, and it really introduces our artist.
Me recuerda cuando iba camino al basurero en la escuela y aquello era una fiesta. Estaba siempre afuera, estaba siempre explorando otras posibilidades, viendo otros tipos de material, soporte. Dale. Hay una técnica del grabado que se llama colagrafía, que es una matriz sobre la cual pegas materia, se bruñe, se limpia y se imprime. ¿Y qué fue lo que hice? Trasladar esta técnica de la colografía, del grabado, al lienzo. Hasta que me di cuenta que ese soporte ya no me rendía, no era lo suficientemente válido. Y me pasó a la madera, que me dio infinitas posibilidades. El primer trabajo que hice sobre este soporte de madera, todavía lo conservo. Tiene un zapato de mi mujer, tiene la tapa de un pomo de compota de mi hijo y tiene el armazón de afuera del primer reproductor de música que tuve. y me di cuenta de que había congelado, que había fosilizado de alguna forma partes de momentos de mi vida, con mi familia, con mi hijo. Es como el trabajo a la inversa del arqueólogo que descubre una cosa, yo la estoy fosilizando para que quede impregnada. Cuando todos mis amigos vieron estas primeras obras, quedaron maravillados, les gustó muchísimo. Y entonces todo el mundo me traía cosas que ya no utilizaba de su casa. Y entonces me di cuenta de lo que estaba haciendo. Me di cuenta de que estaba también poniendo en mis obras, discursando con la historia de mucha gente, con la historia de otras familias, de otros entornos. Eso me pareció genial. En mi búsqueda de material descubro personas que son magníficas. Cerrajeros, plomeros, electricistas, que para mí es un arsenal de material. Además, el entorno de estas personas me es muy familiar. Yo quisiera que tú hubieras visto la mesa de trabajo de mi papá. La mesa de trabajo de mi papá era formidable. Él mismo hacía sus propias herramientas. Mi papá era talabartero y él mismo, de forma muy ingeniosa, con un pequeño tubo, hacía herramientas y eso me ayudó mucho también a configurar mi obra, a la composición. Me ayudó a encontrar conceptos, en mi obra. Todo esto del no desechar nada, de reutilizarlo todo, viene de esas personas. La recolección no es solamente en un basurero. La recolección puede ser en una gaveta de una casa, puede ser en un patio, puede ser en la misma calle, en cualquier lugar. Siempre estoy recolectando. Hay objetos que me llaman más la atención porque en sí mismos tienen una historia. Esa vibración que tiene de todo el uso cotidiano que tuvo viene a empastarse con otra y ya son historias que empiezan a entrelazarse, ¿no? Una de las cosas que más genera expectativa es poder enseñar mi trabajo, que se conozca, que la gente conozca mi trabajo y me conozca como artista. Eso, cuando logras reunir una multitud de personas que vienen sencillamente por un interés visual, porque quieren ver tu trabajo, eso es muy bueno. Ya ese momento de la exposición lo he recreado 2 o 3 veces en mi mente, ¿no? Y eso es otra cosa que me genera muchas expectativas, ¿no? El instante, ¿no?, en que se inaugura la exposición. Sé que falta, que hay un largo camino por recorrer todavía. Hay que trabajar mucho. La transportación de las obras, todas esas cosas. Pero sí he recreado muchas veces eso en mi mente. Y lo he recreado de muchas formas diferentes que ahora mismo no podría explicarte. Me parece que va a ser un lugar muy... Va a ser un momento espectacular, va a ser un momento grandioso para mi trabajo. Va a ser muy bueno.
Website, and we also, the group also has a Facebook page. As Julio says in the movie, and I can tell by these folks, this is going to be an exciting event. I understand that your communication with Julio has been like excellent. I mean, you're able to, no?
Well, the problem is the internet connection in Cuba is still spotty. We can't, for example, Skype or use, you know, face-to-face types of communication that we'd like to. Usually it's email, sometimes it's Facebook Messenger only, he can't get email. But it's okay, you know, we get along. And my Spanish is not real great, but we have people who are bilingual on the committee, and I get all the help I can, and we manage.
Wonderful. Yeah. Now, I understand that Julio will have smaller pieces in the exhibit, but also larger pieces. He's making some very, very large pieces. Maybe, Marty, you would like to show these smaller pieces, which are also...
Well, these will be part of a larger installation. These are little fish. I don't know if you can get in there with the camera.
There we go.
Small fish, but they'll be part of a large school of fish, which will take up, a meter and a half or so.
Wow.
In width. So these were some of the ones, if you noticed in the video, that he was working on and putting that bit of metallic color on them. You can see that they're made out of buttons and just all kinds of things. I'm really charmed by these little fish, and he's loaned us four of them, which we can use and show people until the exhibit.
And you'll be selling these at the exhibit?
Yes. Yes, indeed.
All of Julio's pieces will be for sale. Yes. I think Marty would like to give us a little more background on Julio. In the video, we saw him working, but let's hear a little more about who he is and what he did before he hopes to come here.
Sure. Well, he was born in 1973. He went to art school in Cuba. He has shown in exhibits, one-person shows, all over Cuba, especially around his area in Trinidad, and Sancti Spiritus is the county, the province. I particularly like his artist statement. I think it speaks very truly to who he is and what he's trying to say. He says, "Everything that people consider garbage, I see as a valuable working material. The ideas from our work are born in the work tables of the plumbers, electricians, and locksmith, and the people who patch objects of everyday use. It is typical of the Cuban to not discard things that don't work anymore, because it's perfectly useful to repair other things. The lack of spare parts and poor infrastructure of the service companies give free rein to Cuban ingenuity. They will make do with what they can. You just have to look at the cars from the 1940s and 50s that are still running. I think this is something imperative in order to understand my work." I think that's true. It's really grounded in that sense of Cuban ingenuity. "Each work is a part of a story or someone I know, sometimes trying to make a social portrait from the language of the materials. These works are a social reflection on a very close, very personal scale, as I see my environment and how it interacts in the various practices and strategies that define us as Cubans and make us an indigenous people. Additionally, these works bring with them a message that it is very important to recycle, to reutilize materials that many consider waste. This is an important theme in my work." He has offered to make a mural while he's here as a gift to the city of Reading. So we're working on finding the right location for that, and we want it to be able to involve the youth of the city. Anyone who would be able to sign up and work with him on this. In addition, he'll be giving workshops while he's here. We have yet to organize all of that. Our next meeting is this Thursday, actually, August 11th, at GoggleWorks at 7 o'clock in the evening. We invite people to come and join us, help with this wonderful work of planning, of getting to know Julio. Invite everyone, please, to like our page on Facebook. And we put up there all the various things that we're doing. Last Saturday, we were at Clay on Main in Ole, painting these sort of little plaques, about 5x7. They're little tiles that say Julio Cepeda Exhibition, based on his design for the aviator. So those will be available.
I understand that they will be on sale as part of fundraiser.
They're
at the,
free
at the
for
movies.
Only a $20 donation, Blair. and you can get them at the film festival in September. Yes.
And let's go back to the film festival. Tom, why don't you summarize the time and everything about the film festival so that we're really on board for that?
Yeah, the film festival on Saturdays and Sundays, I think, is going to be very exciting. And it's a 131-seat theater, and generally we're limited to about 125 seats in it, but 131. And 11 o'clock in the morning of Saturday and Sunday is a good time to have the showings, because it's time to present them for an hour and a half, and they have some discussion afterwards. But generally every day, it's not going to interfere with the normal schedule of films, because his films are shown at 3 and at 7 p.m. But we have the equipment there at the GoggleWorks to be able to do a really nice performance of the films. But I think the most important thing will be to get people to come out and not only see the films, but have the discussion afterwards. But that discussion with each individual that's there is going to really help get much more information flowing in the community. So it's really an attention awareness issue that's going to be raised up. So I applaud you for doing it. The films are very good. I've seen two of them. And they're very, in some cases, very provocative. They get you thinking.
And I saw one of them on the screen at GoggleWorks today.
Yeah,
they were working, practicing it.
Trying it, yeah.
So it looks great on the screen. Yeah.
And there's just a technique that the Cuban filmmakers have taken and made on their own, and I wouldn't try to explain it myself. I'm not a filmmaker, but I appreciate good film. And I think people who love film know that the Cuban film is very world-renowned, and they have won awards for it, but I think it's going to be very exciting. So look forward to
the last film, Alumbres, was Cuba gave it as its selection to one of the international shows.
Yes.
I forget which one.
It was in 1968, I think it was on the...
This is the most recent
more,
one.
More
there is the classic one that's 1968, and then the other ones are very, very recent, including the first one that we saw the trailer for is, in fact, only made about a year ago.
Okay.
So that'll be good. And I think it will also tie in with the excitement that and the interest that we have in Reading with the Reading Film Fest. I think there's also closely parallel to this, and it's going to be shown, I think, later on. But again, the film theater at the GoggleWorks is becoming quite a place that people come, and on Monday nights, I don't know if the audience knows this, the new films start on Friday, and on Monday nights at the regular film theater, there's a discussion afterwards. And I think we can start doing this with this kind of film, too. The Cuban films, the art films, international films, it's a wonderful place to get like-minded people come together that are interested in international activities, events, affairs, and the art of stuff.
I love this project because I love intercultural things. It's a chance for us to meet other people. The people involved in your committee are, a lot of them are Latinos.
Well, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Of how do you think that this, the importance of this with regard to centering on peace, and your connection? I know you've asked us our connections, but your connection because of centering on peace has been a very long program in Reading. Many people watch it. And so how do you see this tying into that?
I do centering on peace every fourth month, and we do it every month with different host. Well, I thought it would be great for centering peace because it has to do with understanding other people.
Mm-hmm.
And if we can understand other people, if we can appreciate them, if we can appreciate other people's art, other people's music, it goes a long way to creating peace between us and people that we don't know as well. And Cuba has been closed basically to Americans. So having Cuban artists here, I think, is just really special. And I think it is a piece.
One of the things that I noticed, and I think you did too, even after 57 years of either blockade or embargo, the Cuban people welcome Americans with open arms. And I tell the story in my little Spanish, I was speaking in terms of los primos. I said, we are como primos. He said, no, como primos, como hermanos.
Oh.
We're
which
not
means
like cousins, we're like brothers.
Friend.
We're not like like cousins, we're like brothers. Oh. And they have this feeling that there's so many good connections between here and the States, and they separate out in their minds what they feel is the lost opportunities that our government has imposed on them. Let me put it delicately to that. Mm-hmm. Versus the American people themselves. So they separate out the attitude of the government, the attitude of Americans.
That's amazing.
I don't know, Paul, what's your, any thoughts on that? Any observations or?
No, I come from, you know, a Latino family, so I can relate to the culture. It's very similar, South American, Caribbean, Spain, because that's another reason why I'm here, I'm part of this committee, is to embrace the Latino culture, and hopefully get more people involved into the art.
I'd like to ask Marty in our last minute, so you got this idea, this dream when you were in Cuba, okay? So it's like multiplied, and it's like you were pretty smart to plant it in a 3-year span, so that he would be coming in 2018, not like tomorrow.
Well, I'm not so smart. He actually asked for that span of time. Julio did. We could have had the exhibit in 2017. There was space at GoggleWorks to do it then. Mm-hmm. But for an exhibit this size, he has to come up with almost 50 pieces. It'll be in Cohen Gallery West, which is the gallery right near where the films are shown there. And he knew he needed some lead time. So
did you have an idea of how big this was going to become?
I wanted it this big and bigger, absolutely. Oh, okay. I think his work touches people. When they see it and think about the use of materials, the humor, and there's no one that does this exact thing. Mm-hmm. I think he'll be able to have a spark here and get young people involved in the mural when he does it. I've seen his workshop proposals. We hope to get those on the website soon, but they are wonderfully creative, little tiny projects that people can do in a weekend. But he's an experienced teacher and experienced with working people, and I think we can look forward to a wonderful time with him when he's here.
I'd like to close by thanking Marty and her husband, Jay, for getting this project started. And I mean, when we see it, the exhibition in the GoggleWorks Gallery, which is a very large space, if you haven't been there, it's going to be extraordinary. Mm-hmm. And don't forget the Film Fest in September, Saturday and Sunday, 11 o'clock, each weekend in September. They will be showing, and I should do a disclaimer. I'm also involved in this somewhat, as you may have surmised by now. But we will be showing Julio Cepeda's introductory film there, and then the feature film as well. So please plan on coming out. Thank you very much. Thanks again for tuning in to Centering on Peace. It's a pleasure to have you here. It's a pleasure to have this program. Thank you.